Would you like to support Cubs Out Loud? One way is to join us over on Patreon. For as little as a buck a month, patrons get early access to our shows, the pre and post show, and various other rewards. You can learn more at patreon.com/cubsoutloud. Thanks to all of our patrons for their support in making this podcast. In this episode of Cubs Out Loud, it's time for another installment in our Let's Talk About Kink series. The Cubs are joined again by Tony, aka Cubses, to guide them through the BDSM online test. Listen in as the guys compare their results amongst each other and over the years. Find out who's the rope bunny and which of them likes to lurk in the shadows and watch. It's bound to be an eye-opening and educational experience. Let's get kinky tonight as COL746 starts now. It's Sunday, July 14th, 2024. I'm Jeff.
Who's your bear? That's right. I am your bear.
I'm Damon.
I don't brew the tea. I just serve it.
And that makes me Gary.
Everyone else is thinking it, and I just say it.
Welcome to Cubs Out Loud, the Bear Podcast of Indeterminate Length, episode number 746. And we have Tony with us. Yay!
Hi.
The Cubs is here.
In multiple ways.
That was kind of a pun.
I said Cubs is here.
Thank you.
Cubs is here. Yay.
Cubs is, Tony, whatever works. How's everybody?
Good. Very happy.
If you weren't listening to the pre-show, I'm doing great.
Woo-hoo. To find that out, subscribe to be a patron. But as much as a buck of it out.
Get the pre and post shows.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, of course, every time we have Tony here, it's time for this. Can we get kinky tonight? I got so many things on my mind. I've never seen a guy so fine. I like it when you tell me to me.
You know, I always forget.
White guys jamming to some hip hop.
I always forget we have that clip until we play it, and I'm like, "That is a good clip. That is a good clip." Mm-hmm. Some of our clips are pretty wild.
Yeah,
but you know, there's that.
I think I know the artist. Yeah, so fun.
Let's talk about kink, Gary. What specifically are we getting kinky with it?
Y'all ready for a quiz? And all of a sudden, I thought Pump Up the Jam was going to play. I don't know why. I was like, oh, man. If I thought ahead, we could have had another audio cue.
You're like the teacher who walks in and goes, how is everybody ready for a quiz?
But and then the entire different classroom goes,
But this is a fun quiz.
Yes.
It's a kinky quiz. So for those that don't know, this thing that we're going to talk about today has been around in this iteration, I will say, since 2014. It's an online website. You go to bdsmtest.org, and you can actually take what's called the BDSM test. And it goes through a series of items. I guess there's like a lighter version and a full version. I think all of us did the full version. Mm-hmm. And so we were going to talk about like what this thing is and what are our feelings on it. Some of us have done it a couple of times over the course of our lifetime. I was the virgin. I had never taken it before, but I've seen people post and share it way back in the day. We kind of made a reference to like LiveJournal. Some people might have posted it on Facebook or MySpace maybe.
It's been in my bigger city profile for years.
There you go.
And by the way, my name on Bigger City has changed. It is now Box Cubby instead of Box Puppy. It's
there you go. That works. So I think one of the things we'll talk about is how if you create a profile, and you remember your profile login, you could go back and like retake the test and see how things change over time. If things change, or do your preferences stay the same? And so before we kind of get into like what our results were, I'm a little curious what your relationship is with this, like how you guys kind of heard of it or had not heard of it maybe very much. I don't think it gets talked about as much these days I think in prevalence. I don't remember seeing it now.
I think I saw it first on somebody's profile on some site somewhere.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't remember where, because, it must have been around 2019.
That's fair.
Like October that I saw it. Maybe before then, and then, we started the Let's Talk About King series. I'm like, maybe I should just take it. Just see what it has.
I'm fairly certain I found it on LiveJournal.
Yeah, needless to say, sorry. I think I agree with my results. But then,
Well, so, yeah, like, I remember seeing people post and embed in their, like, websites. I don't want to say this goes back to like GeoCities.
Oh God, no.
But we old. But I do remember like people kind of like, copy pasting or more than likely screenshotting what the results look like, because what we're going to end up sharing and posting on our blog is very like straightforward black and white. But when you go in, your actual results, come up with this really kind of colorful gradation, and like from most to least in terms of alignment of what based on what your answers were. And I thought that was really kind of interesting. And that's the part I remember most, I think, is seeing the color like variation of what people reported. But I will own that I was never really a person who was trying to like meet other people of like interest, so I just never really bothered to take it, because I was like, well, okay, like, that's one way or one measurement.
Yeah, to be fair, I'm sure both times I've taken this quiz, my thoughts were around the lines of, this is a quiz very much, maybe a little more specific, but kind of along the lines of, what Pokemon are you? It's not necessarily supposed to be 100% seriously.
I think it's into the right category.
Yeah, it maybe gives you an idea, and being like, "Huh, I never looked into thought about that kink, but apparently I might be a little more interested. It might be something you start exploring, but because this is more." Because like, especially the longer one, more trying to get down and actually come up with relatively good answer versus the Pokemon one, which is like for funsies.
Right.
Well, I guess I'll ask this question as a quick sidebar because of what you said, Jeff. Like, how do we feel about this being a starting point, perhaps a tool for people who don't really know their interest or levels in BDSM kink as one way to learn more about themselves? Like, do we think it's like too advanced or doesn't do enough to help somebody or let them get their feet wet, so to speak?
I'm kind of on the fence in a way. Like the questions that it asks tend to lead to someone who already knows a little bit about like BDSM and kink and such. It doesn't feel like a starter, but on that same token, it could help, as Jeff was kind of indicating. But I don't think, going back to, because it's literally, I literally took it again this morning. Going back to some of the questions and the way they were stated, I don't think someone who knows nothing at all about kink would truly understand the scope of the questions.
Okay.
But that's just that's my opinion.
For me, I think it's something that you could take multiple times and see your own evolution in it. But kind of like what you were saying, Damon, of once you understand some of the concepts and phrasing and what it's meaning, now you can kind of drill into whether you really like it or not.
Right.
And one thing I think is also a key to it is after multiple takings of it, you kind of get an idea on like, oh, hey, there's going to be this later question that comes up that's similar to this. So you might adjust slightly on repeated takings as well.
Yeah.
But well, I think it's a fairly starting point. And then you can, as you develop, you can continue.
I mean, to your point, Damon, like I just logged back in to kind of look at some of the statements. So basically, you get to choose on a scale of absolutely disagree to neutral slash no opinion or absolutely agree. And there's like 7 points on the scale that you can measure to each statement. So all the way from absolutely disagree all the way over to absolutely agree or in between. And there's like these color codes. So absolutely agree is basically red. Absolutely agree is green. And then kind of in between is like a yellowish color. So like if you don't know what some of these words are or you're not that familiar with it, absolutely I agree. Like you would have to kind of learn. So if you don't really know what submission is, if you don't know what domination or being dominated is, like then this is already too far ahead of where the person is trying to take the test.
I feel like I feel like this could potentially be good for or great for a newbie into kink. Like someone who has maybe started their journey or is partnering with a dom or a sir or a mentor of that type and want to get to know themselves a little better and find out how they feel about certain things. And it'll give them a starting point or a guide to like, okay, you tend to feel more like this. Let's see what we can do from there. Or you got this rank, you know, this number, this percentage in this thing. Let's explore that.
Right. Well, and so on the info page for the website, it talks about the definition of like BDSM and in those terms is just like a high level. And then it goes on to talk about the archetypes. And it does say real quick, I'm just going to quote it. It says, everyone is different and finding two kinksters with the exact same preferences is probably impossible. There are, however, a few common archetypes that people can identify with to varying degrees. And then it explains from like 0 to 100. Curious to what extent each archetype suits you, take the test. And then it goes on to explain the list below by no means is complete, but it should cover the most common ones. So they own right from the very beginning, like we are not the source.
Right.
But can be helpful. I see it very much as a tool that's very insightful on you as a person.
Right.
I don't know if I would consider it a lot as a measurement of me with another person.
Right.
But again, I'm not that much into like kink or BDSM that I would think in those terms, I guess, like trying to figure that out.
So what I was thinking was because there's, like you mentioned, the 3 different extremes where you're completely agreed, completely disagree or neutral. Mm-hmm. Probably a lot of new folks will be more towards that neutral area because they don't necessarily know what they like and what they dislike. Whereas as you get more experience, you're going to definitely lean towards one side or the other more. So it'll probably give you, like you were saying, that direction, that idea that, hey, maybe you like submission more. So let's explore that a little bit.
Yeah. And especially if people are being truthful for themselves and thinking like, oh, that does sound, I haven't really experienced that. I'm not sure how much I would like something like that. But it sounds interesting to me, so maybe they'll put a tick or two to the right, and, or they're like, not so much, but I tick and so to the left. And then sometimes just like, no fucking way.
Yeah.
Just all the way
well,
to the
and
right.
That's...
Or hell yes, all the way to the right. It's and it's also being, if they're being truthful to themselves and being like, Okay, I disagree with that, but how much do I actually disagree with that? Like,
right.
Maybe a little? Then that's probably just like one tick to the left versus all the way to the far left for disagreeing. And getting that, which probably gives a little bit of percentage for them, but just how, if you look at the list and you see some, you have 1% of something, it's like, yeah, probably not into that. I would think that, like, percentage-wise, if you were to actually do, hey, and is this something I'm actually into, anything that's greater than 50, you're probably at least a little into it. Anything below 50, you're probably not into it at all.
Right.
Well, and it's interesting that the way you guys were saying that, because I was thinking, for anybody who has not really done this before and or may not really consider themselves much into kink or BDSM, I thought that it would be very polarizing. Mm. Like if anything, I didn't think that people would kind of be to the middle. I figured they'd be like, hell no, like absolutely not. I am not into that. Like, you know, and so I was thinking there would be a lot more absolute disagrees and potential 0% categories. But right. Your point is well taken, Jeff, that, you know, people might be like, well, like, I don't know. Like, I mean, it happened to me. Like, there was some stuff and I was like, I don't know about that. But I wasn't willing to just go absolute disagree, because to me, that's a shutout.
Mm-hmm.
As in, like, never in a million years, not going to happen. Like,
yeah,
go knock on somebody else's door. You know, like.
And realize that the output from the categories, they're combining questions. So an answer of no way on one question may only affect 20% of that final score.
Right.
Right. And I think there's also going to be the how you interpret the results later when you get them. Mm-hmm. So as we were saying earlier about like discovering this and kind of finding it, yeah, I remember seeing it. I don't quite remember like who all had it, but I definitely know it was probably making the rounds amongst the leather folk I knew.
Like, yeah.
They were most likely the ones that were that, or that was a way they were revealing an aspect of themselves. They were using this as no pun intended, like a flag, like, you know, kind of like, you know, a hanky of sorts to be like, if you're interested to know more, please read this, you know.
Yeah,
kind of a thing.
Like I feel like my first inkling of it was either Twitter or FetLife, and I'm leaning more towards FetLife because it's something like it. For those that don't know, FetLife is sort of a Facebook for kinksters, to keep it broad in general. And there's a, like, you get a social stream of things. So more than likely, like, someone posted theirs, and it's like, oh, this is a thing. So you look at it, and multiple people start doing the test and posting their results. And then I know with some, it was showing up on their like profiles and giving this, again, give people an idea of what they were interested in. And that's why I feel like I probably first saw it on FetLife, and because I wanted to take the test and wanted to add it to my profile. So,
mm-hmm. So there have been variations of this for decades. I remember getting it before the web. off of an old BDS, and it was much more into specific kinks than it wasn't just BDSM. So it's probably different group has done this version, but I think this one was very fair on the way they were asking questions. It didn't seem like it was trying to lead you one direction or the other.
I would be intrigued to know on the background programming how much they've like utilized research principles and like how to state things without swaying the end user into a specific kind of answer. And yet, like, I don't feel like it's completely finessed. And the reason why I say it is like, so I went back in, like I was taking it again. And the very first thing it says, I like to be dominated, comma, especially in the bedroom. And I'm like, the qualifier, especially in the bedroom, I feel like it should be clear as a statement. Like, I like to be dominated in the bedroom. And then there should be another time it should just say, I like to be dominated. Because to me, those are two different things.
See, and that's where I kind of interpreted it as it was a very specific question. It was asking if you like to be dominated and separating out the bedroom portion. It was calling out the fact that you have a dom-sub relationship outside of the bedroom.
Again, and I think that's part of it. You can get, like, looking at the questions we're trying and remembering some of it, you can start getting into the semantics of stuff, like the way certain things were stated and kind of being like, maybe. Like, I had to read some questions a couple of times just because I was like, did I get that right? Did I understand what they were actually trying to say? Not that the questions were, our statements were misleading. It's just that sometimes the way it was stated became, it grayed the potential answer for me. It, you know, it blurred it a bit. Yeah, I will say there are very few questions for me that I went fully one way or the other. I think it's like 100% in either direction, yes or no. Mm-hmm. Agree, disagree. Yeah. So
there was way more than I expected, to be honest.
to that you said yes, absolutely. Ah. Well, yeah. No, I didn't have as many of those. I don't think I had as many.
Well, I think that that could be reflected in the answers, and that's the part that I find intriguing. I'm looking over all of our scores that we reported out, and most of us have a couple of items that are 0%.
Mm-hmm.
And a 0% says to me, like, that's an absolute disagree activity interest type thing. And then Tony's the only one currently that has 100%.
You got 100 on the test.
So yeah, I mean, like, I find that interesting. Like, I was really curious to see what mine was going to come out as, because I felt like I was doing a lot of middle of the road stuff, like not dead center, but like wasn't really one direction or another. And that kind of did come out in the end when I saw my scores. My top score is 73.
Yeah.
So I'm not that committed to anything as an absolute.
Which I think is fair. Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, I'll also feed in that there's a little bit of a challenge. You know how you're told, like, don't go to the grocery store on an empty stomach. Don't take this test if you're wound up.
Yeah, probably.
Because it will probably affect your answers.
Well, I mean, that's fair. I mean, I think, you know, if the horn is, you know, acting up and raging, that might not be a good time to take the test, because then you're going to be like, like, you know,
like,
really...
oh, that sounds so hot. Figuring out how your dick is responding to the current thing. Ooh, that's the dick downer.
Right. I mean, like, you could have lots of different body sensations, like not just like, you know, physicality in terms of genitalia. Like, you might find yourself tensing up at the thought or the concept of a thing that is presented in the test.
Right.
I know for me, I did a lot of reflecting on what my behaviors have been, not what I think they will be in the future.
Right.
Which is, I think, fair, but I was really conscious of that as I was answering some of the questions, because I was like, I've discovered there are certain things that I probably will do again, as in I did them in the past and I liked them.
Right.
But it was new. It's like, I don't feel like I have a lot of experience, but like, it's a thing that I would be okay with.
Exactly. There was a part of me that was looking at the questions and thinking, trying to kind of do what you were doing, Gary, was not talking about like future, but thinking about my past experiences, my past opportunities, my, and, you know, current quote unquote, you know, things that I'm into and not into. And that helped guide some of my answers. For example, because I remember the question, and it's one of the few questions I said absolutely no on. And is that, I think there was one that's talking about like water sports, if I'm remembering. That's a solid no. Like, you are not peeing on me. Sorry. No. just personal preference, what have you. But have I engaged in water sports in the past? Yes. As the top or dom, in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So for yourself, you're against it, but not necessarily for others.
Right. Right.
Well, and that does bring up an interesting point as to what you would be willing to participate in and what role you would take in that particular thing. Like, there were some questions in here, if I remember correctly, about your partner.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was kind of starting to tiptoe into you were if you have a partner now, or if you had a partner, if you were to have a partner, these are the things that how would you feel about that? Because there was, I think, a couple of questions in terms of poly kind of stuff. And I was oh, that's interesting. I think there was one about whether or not you would participate in a group scene, with your partner or something. Just little things along that line. I was interesting. So I'm wondering what the past versions of this test have been like. So if it's been around for 10 years, I cannot imagine it hasn't changed in terms of the statements as time has gone by, that they found ways to be more specific or introduce items that may not have been there before, is my guess, but I could be wrong about that.
I'm guessing that we could probably get archive.org up and see what the old test looked like from a decade ago. One of the things I think has changed also is society attitudes. So 10 years ago, BDSM, even in the non-gay community, would have raised a little more eyebrows, I think, than it does now. Issues of watching your partner have sex, that's become an ongoing joke in political circles now. I mean, the terminology and the logic has moved into mainstream culture. So I think people now probably recognize some of the terms more than they did 10 years ago.
Well, and to that point, I think, let's go back to the turn of the century. Let's go back to 2000. At that time, I'm just thinking it's almost
a quarter of 1900s.
No,
wrong century.
Yeah, the most recent one, Tony. What I was going to say is look at how much technology and the landscape has changed.
Yeah.
From 2000 to now, if you go back to the millennia, Y2K and all that stuff that some of us were experiencing. I realize some of you listening and or watching may not have been born yet. It's okay. we just didn't have as much connectivity, and there wasn't as much out there in the world. So to your point about how some of these things are kind of jokes in certain spheres now. The Anthony Weiner exposure thing.
Yeah.
That hadn't happened before. So I think there was a sense of a lot more privacy, 20 some years ago, that people just didn't know these things. And yet, if you take a moment and think about it logically, you're of course people were shtupping, in the workplace, or, giving handies in public parks and doing, this, that, or the other, or trying to get out of, traffic citations, with a little something, something for law enforcement. I mean, it just wasn't kind of talked about. I think it was more fantasized or theorized. So we saw it in the media. We saw it in porn. We saw it in stories that were written, all that kind of stuff. And now I feel a lot of that is much more, oh God, the only thing that came to mind was obtainable. And I don't think that's the right way to phrase it, but it's much more accessible? Realistic.
Accessible.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That there's a possibility that those things, and people are way more willing, I think, now than ever to role play things out. So we've kind of talked about it a little bit before about law enforcement and uniforms and how that's kind of a touchy area. And it has, I think, unfortunately, continued to be. I don't feel like that's really kind of calmed down in terms of, you know, that aspect. And yet, we very well know that there are people who want that kind of an experience. They want to be in that role play with another person who's in a uniform, who possibly is the authority figure and has some kind of jurisdiction, power, control, authority, dominance, whatever you want to call it, over them. And to me, I feel like, well, now of all the times in the world is when you probably can feel the, I guess I want to say the safest in terms of like having that experience, because you know that you can set up, well, I'm bringing a lot to the table, I just realized. You can set up the parameters. Do you know what I mean? Like, you can have the discussion ahead of time about what you're looking for, what you want out of that, so to speak, as a scene with another person or people, I guess.
Right. A lot of it is, I think, is the ability to consent. It's having the knowledge of what you're getting into. And I think that awareness is there now, whereas before it was all fantasy of like, ooh, I'll be in this situation. But the reality would be you don't know how to take advantage of that situation, so you get taken advantage of.
Right.
Well, and that was some of the questions in here, right? Like, there was there was questions kind of about, and they didn't phrase it this way, but I guess I can interpret it as consensual non-consent. Mm. Like, I felt there was sort of a borderline about that, like that you were willing to role play or do something in which, like, I don't know, like maybe I'm misimagining or reimagining that or something.
Like, your desires are relevant, or their desires are relevant.
Yeah,
I think there was one like. Oh, go ahead.
No, I think the question was like, you don't care, but you don't care what's happening as long as your partner is happy, kind of in a sense. Like, you don't care what happens to you, or it didn't say it that way. I'm very much paraphrasing.
Right.
But that's sort of the idea of that question was, like, they can do what they want if they are getting pleasure and it doesn't matter about you. That sounds really bad when I say it that way, but that's sort of the general idea of the question.
Right.
And honestly, that would be if you were somebody that leaned heavily in the submissive side, you may not want the choice. You may want to be the pleasure. That would be your, like, if you're heavy into submissive and heavy into masochism, you may not want the choice of what's coming. So, but the key would be finding somebody that you trust to give that control to.
Right.
Not correct. The random police officer that pulls you over.
The thing that came to mind when you're talking about the change from like 2000 to now was, like, in the past, a lot of this would have been seen as taboo. Like, people wouldn't have openly discussed it and are admitted to it, you know, admitted to their feelings, admitted to their personal, like, desires or kinks. And I don't want to say kink has become mainstream, but with the, you know, technology and more knowledge, people have grown to know a bit more about it and be more understanding and respectful is the way I'm thinking of it. Sort of a weird example. So I won a title last year. Since I leather, it was a leather title. One of the first, like, pictures that showed up, because it was a, you know, someone's public page. When you're tagged in a photo on Facebook, like, everyone kind of knows.
Mm-hmm.
It was a picture of me in a contest, and my aunt liked it. and I was kind of like, well, that's going to be something that I needed to address. Because,
or not.
Yeah.
Right, you could just leave that dog lie. You don't have to wake it
well,
up.
Well, I didn't like reach out to her directly and at like start the conversation. But what I ended up doing was I put, basically, for lack of a better phrase, a public service announcement on my Facebook page, kind of saying, hey, I won this contest. It was a leather title. If you want to ask questions about it, ask me questions. If you don't want to see this, because it's going to be there, you should make a personal decision on how you choose to follow me in the future. Like, that was sort of my idea, was like,
right,
you're going to know this is going to be a thing. And realistically, I did not have full control over what would be getting out there. So I made a point to kind of address that head on in a way. Fast forward to Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. And I'm having dinner with my brother and sister-in-law, and them asking questions about the title, like what it meant and everything, and trying to explain it without, like, let me just give you really surface level shit, because I don't know if we're ready to have the deeper conversation about my personal interest in kinks and fetishes. I don't know if you're ready to have that conversation. So it stayed very surface level, and I'm glad they, like, understood. And again, that respect, quote unquote, was there, where they weren't judging. They were just curious and asking questions and wanting to know a little bit more about what it meant.
So. And it's actually really cool that they asked you, because that's got to be a bit of a hurdle to ask family about.
Mm-hmm. Because there's another side of my family that I had to, like, basically block from my Facebook because, they were not happy. But that's another story.
I did have a question for everybody here about the test.
Okay.
I had a question about the test for everybody here.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things for me when I was taking the test, I was, and I pointed this out to you, Gary, was that it felt very much like it was aimed towards a pansexual, non-gender type of category, where it did occasionally get into, like, boy, girl. But for the dom side, it tended to lean more towards dom as the terminology. Right. It didn't really ever say sir boy. So I was curious if, from a gay perspective, how people felt about that. Did any questions catch you off guard?
I didn't feel like anything caught me off guard. It really felt to me to be sexuality neutral.
Okay.
Like, this test isn't for the gays. It's not for the heteros. It's for anybody who's into BDSM. And they were trying to keep everything relatively gender neutral. So it's like, you're dom, you're dominant, you're submissive, but what sex or sexuality each of those are doesn't matter. That's not the point of the test. So I felt they were being respectful enough in keeping the test open enough so that anybody could take it, and it wasn't specifically for one sexuality or set of genders. No.
So
if they, I think that'd be what you mean by pansexual.
The challenge for me in the gay community is that sir boy has a different meaning than master slave, for example.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
In the gay community, there is a distinction between that, but you can't have both. But they didn't really terminology slave boy or a sir boy. So as a result, you were kind of left to come up with your own terminology. And that's where I didn't know how far people took dominant. Like, did you take it all the way to MS, or did you stop at sir boy?
Oh. Interesting.
I kind of took it like, because there was, you're right, there was the questions which were dom sub versus master slave. I felt like those questions were talking about how extreme are you on this scale.
Okay.
It's like dom sub is just whatever you would categorize that as, and it could be anything. And then it's like, okay, are you thinking along the lines on when it comes to Master Slate or versus Sir Boy, if are you thinking that extreme of Master Slave, or are you thinking Sir Boy? Because Sir Boy is still Dom Sub, and Master Slave is still Dom Sub. They're both kind of in those categories. So they were just trying to be like, okay, here's a neutral thing about this, and then they have the test of how extreme are you on that scale. And that's where those that set kind of triggered in. And may have weighted all your Dom Sub ones more to the extreme if you were pointed that way based off the Master Slave questions. I don't know for how that all works. But depending on how you answer those is how it would weight it on that scale.
Yeah. Looking at the test, like looking at the categories that I'm seeing here on our results, just really quickly, there are a few words here that you get those words, but you don't get Sir Boy, or you get Boy. Never mind, I see that. I don't see Sir. That's the one word I do not see. Like, I see Boy and Girl. I see Daddy, Mommy. I see Slave. I see Master, Mistress. I see Owner, which might be the one that maybe relates, but not really. But I don't see, like, Sir. And that's interesting.
Well, that was, for speaking for me, like, one of the challenges I had was a lot of times when it referred to Boy, Girl, sometimes it was referring to, like, age play.
Mm-hmm. Like
younger, not necessarily submissive. And so, for me, that was one of the challenges of, like, how is this question worded? And that kind of gets into the consent topic before of, like, if you're much more in the submissive, like, super down on the slave side of things, you probably don't want that choice. So right. A boy would probably want more choice than
that
would be. So
And that's very true. Like, that's, I think, as someone who has experienced some of the, like, different dynamics, I get that. I have seen the, like, master-slave portion of it and the lack of control, are having, essentially, someone is making the decisions for you, as opposed to you have some say in that decision. And don't get me wrong, I think even with, depending on the relationship, even with a master-slave sort of dynamic, there is still some say. It is just more or less, there's a master that gives the direction without question, as it were. They take your feedback and your interest into account when they make the decision for you.
It's a longer scene that isn't just that one individual scene. So they're basing their consensual experience on across the board.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. But interesting.
The reason I had to ask that was because that's kind of why, if you ever go into my results, you'll notice that I skew very heavily away from certain things, because I did have that mindset in when I was going in.
Yeah, I was looking at your results and I was a little surprised-ish, I would say, but
really
not. No, I'm considering what we know of his role and dynamic. I was a little surprised that certain things weren't up there. But again, I think, as you were saying, I think we all, looking at the results in a sense, like, we were all kind of going Boy falling more into age play than Sir Boy dynamic.
I didn't even think about that, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Jeff. It didn't occur to me. And now that you brought it up, I'm like, well, I guess that would be feedback for them, and they'd have to figure out a way to list that, like, in the statements and the category, how they're going to do that particular thing. They might have to do something with like capitalization and non-capitalization. I don't know, like a way to like make sense of it. So when you see it this way, it means this. But when you see it this way, it means something else.
Or if you're just consistent throughout the entire test, you're probably okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's what I think happens.
I mean, in terms of our results, I will say, Tony, like today when, you know, I was putting it into the document and looking at it, I was like, I'm not necessarily surprised by the results. I mean, the top, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I would say your top 10 are very much what I know of you. So like, that's where I was like, oh, that checks out. But it also like it definitely was intriguing to me. So like on the dock right now, we have Jeff's 2019 results and his 2024 results. And so there's been some shift, some change in 5 years for him, which
I'm a little surprised on actually the number one, which is the same on both, but
the percentage?
I thought they would have matched, but apparently not.
Well, something shifted in that case.
I did notice that my brattiness apparently went down. Went from 97% to 59%. Submissive actually went up a little. I think it's right. I feel that's definitely right, just because I feel like I've leaned more into that. I think the voyeur part of it, which I'm at 95% currently, was at 67. I think that really changed considering, access to porn can be a little bit easier nowadays.
Well, so I was going to say, I wouldn't be surprised that like things change over time because of experience or exposure, like whatever way you want to phrase that.
Yeah, this is 5 years different, so.
Right. And so
there was also a pandemic in the middle of that, too.
Yeah.
You mean when a lot of people were home with their computers and
voyeurism would have been up? Yeah.
Yeah.
You mean fair. It's almost like OnlyFans and Just for Fans really kind of skyrocketed during the pandemic? What? Strange. But yeah, like, I mean, when I looked at mine, I was like, huh, interesting. Like, I think it's fair. I also think it opens my mind in a way to make me realize that I wasn't quite, I think, as fully consciously aware of some things.
Oh.
Because I don't think about these things. Like, I don't dwell on them or kind of really, I guess, do all that much in the way of, you know, activity. So I was like, Like, I really feel like I'm trying to look at, like, for, like, the halfway point. So how many measurements are there? There's, like, 20 plus 20. Okay. So, yeah, like, only 10 of mine, my top 10 are above 50. Everything else is below. Mm. Whereas Tony has 14 that are in the top half. Which is, I mean, personally to me, not necessarily that surprising. and I'm not trying to be shady or anything. I'm just saying, like, I think you're much more experienced.
That's a fact. There's a reason why we have
9 or 80% or above.
Yeah. Hmm? You have 3 100s.
I can spell them out if it makes it easy.
Teacher's pet. I'm kidding. But, you know, no, I definitely think, I think that it is a good way to be a little insightful to stuff.
Here's what I've learned from your list, Gary. You're just not that kinky of a person. You got a little bit, but
Well, I don't think I'm. The word that came to mind that I struggle on is severe, and I don't think that's the right way I want to phrase that. I don't think it's a strength.
Mm. Yeah.
But that may be due to experience.
Or lack thereof.
Correct. Like, yeah. Like, I think, you know, if somebody was to approach me and be like, oh, I'd really be into this, I'd be like, okay. But I'd also feel like, I don't really have a lot of background in that, so... I'd have to make some serious considerations about what they're looking for, what they want.
So for,
right.
So if a really hot guy had come up to you and handed you a bunch of rope and said, tie me up, would you try that out?
Yes. Like, I would absolutely do that. However, the first thing that popped in my head just now when you said that is I was like, what kind of rope? It's true. Because then my next thought was, well, I might have to like get something as a barrier between the rope and their skin. Mm. If it's something that might like, you know,
I mean, sex appropriate rope.
If you didn't have to worry about the details.
Yeah. Oh, if I didn't have to worry about the details. No.
But
then...
we're talking about Gary here. He's always worried about the details.
Right.
Yeah.
These two as co-hosts, they're like, that's not a thing. That's not a thing.
I think that's sort of maybe where you lie in a way, Scary. You would not do something on a whim. Maybe.
No, you're not wrong. If you're like, watching my facial reaction, I was like, well, I might be able to do something on a whim. And I was like, well, no, like whim implies a lot of trust in an unexpected way. And I'm like, I don't know. Like if there were certain people involved and it came up unexpectedly, then that would probably be a much stronger yes.
Right.
But like, let's say that we're at an event and there's like a public space and like someone's going to be doing impact play. Someone's going to be flogging. I've been flogged. I don't mind it. But if I don't know the person, I'm not going to be that whimsical and just jump right in. Unless you, Tony, Chess, like somebody I know is present and says, I can vouch for them. I know them. Like I can attest to their skill, like their whatever, like, because otherwise I'd be like, and also like if they've already been doing this with somebody else, that now has an effect, because if I'm seeing them with another person and maybe that person really likes like severe impact, that could make me resistant because I'm like, well, I'm not here to be beat up, I'm not a side carcass of beef that you could just beat the shit out of, like where other people would really, you know, feel drawn to that. And that's unfair to them, so to speak, as a dom or as a top in that situation. Cause my observation is like, wow, they're like really, kind of lean into this. And I'd be like, well, I'm don't want that, but that's not fair because I don't, if all I'm doing is taking that one moment, I'm not giving them the credit of the moment to find out, like, can they do the same with less energy or less gusto, I guess, or whatever.
So if Chess was approaching you with a bunch of rope in his hands and giving you this grin and this like little side look at you like, huh? Would you let him tie you up?
I'm watching Tony's questions. Because there is a part of me that,
by the way.
No, I know. I think it's the reason why I'm kind of looking to Tony, because I know, like, seeing Tony's results, I'm like, Tony's a 99% voyeur, so it's guaranteed that if Chess is approaching me...
He's probably right Tony's behind him.
Right. So, more than likely, Tony's going to be sitting in the corner on his knees, like, watching her or something. Like, that's... Right. Yeah, that's what that is.
A guilty.
Ready to take care. Ready with the camera in case you wanted some souvenirs.
I wish you could say that hasn't happened before, but it has.
Yeah. I can't imagine you being in that position. Yeah, no, I think that's fair. No, and that's really what it comes down to. Like, that's what I had to learn. And I kind of talked about it, I think, on the podcast before. Like, working at Roseland as a co-manager for a couple of seasons, that's really when I learned about kink and BDSM, because we had weekends. And, like, the groups would come in, and there were some really beautiful, gracious people from Pennsylvania and Ohio, in West Virginia, probably, that, like, gave me the opportunity to be a silent observer. And that was pivotal to understanding scenes and dynamic and, like, what people do, because I just didn't get it. Like, I am one of those, I don't want to say convert, but I came around because when I was younger, I was very much like, what the fuck is wrong with these people? Like, how broken do you have to be to let somebody do that to you? Like, I saw it as a severe psychological thing.
Oh, wow.
I was that jerk. Like, I was like, wow. I was like, you know, I was very much in the, you really need to go to therapy. Like if you're allowing to have someone beat the shit out of you or treat you like a dog and put you in a cage and, like, blah, blah, like, just all this stuff. Like, I was not an open-minded person.
And now you recognize that is the therapy.
In some cases, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, no, it changed it was such a paradigm shift to sit in on an impact scene and to just silently watch. Because the Dom had said, I'm willing to let you observe, but there's a couple of rules. Like, they were very good from the very beginning. They were like, you get to watch, you do not get to leave, you do not get to interrupt, you do not ask any questions until we're done. Is that understood? And I was like, sure. But, and then they, you know, they had cleared it with the sub and said, do you mind if they observe? Like, I've set these, you know, ground rules or whatever. It was so life-changing for me, because I was kind of like I just got to witness and then try to go through my own mental journey and figure out what was happening. And there was so much to observe that I didn't really understand or know. Like, I had never taken into consideration how a dom will, like, check in with the sub and how a dom would have so much compassion in, like, the moment of, like, that energy exchange. Like, it just didn't, it was not in my wheelhouse, like, did not compute, did not think about it. And so that was mind altering to, like, see that happen and to know that that took place. And I will say this, the sub wanted it to be more and more severe. The Dom went with that, was a little uncomfortable, eventually stopped, and then owned that they felt bad, because one of the things that happened that they had not agreed to was that they had broke skin. And I got to see this journey of this Dom emotionally going through that they went too far, that, like, that hadn't quite been fully discussed and agreed upon, and they felt like they had broke that. In that moment and what came, and then, like, so the aftercare was different aftercare. Like, it was really, really, really interesting to me. And I think they were very conscious of the fact that now they have someone watching, and that's not what they.
Yeah.
But I never, like, felt, and the sub did not, you know, hold them accountable in any way or feel bad about it or anything. Like, so yeah, like, it was really, really interesting. But a part of me has thought for many years, I wish everyone could do that. Like, everyone could have that opportunity to observe, to learn. Mind you can sit still and keep your mouth shut. Because those were two key things. Like, you can't be disruptive. You can't get you can't involve yourself. And this is not a show and tell where you get to ask a lot of questions and be like, what are you doing? And what's that? And blah, blah, blah. Like, that's not how this works. Like, you know.
Right.
So I have a story on that, but I don't want to spend a lot of time on it. But that was the first scene of Chess and I, was we were doing a scene for someone else. And So that person was in a chair, tied, had to watch, and it was basically had the St. Andrew's cross out, and we did the scene in front. And we hadn't negotiated a whole bunch of stuff in advance. We just basically worked off of what our experience was. And that's that experience right there kind of told us that we fit, because every single motion he made, I countered it, and it just seemed to work like a really good dance where we were able to express this, and the person watching also could see that. And so it was a very unique experience that I will probably never have again. And it say life-changing would be understating it.
Well, I mean, to your point, Tony, about like never experiencing it again, like I'm going to use an analogy, I guess. I don't know how appropriate it is, but I feel like it's like your virgin. It's like losing your virginity. Like it is a one-time thing. It is impossible to have that happen again.
Right.
And that's where I think, like, as a society, we kind of put pressure on people, like a certain significance of, like, you know, of an experience. It's like, oh, and then, you know, it'll never happen again. And it's like, yeah, but sometimes it's not good. So I think that's a little too heavy-handed to put a lot of pressure on people on people's first time experiences. There are times where it's absolutely like foundational and incredibly important. And there are other times where it is not. So, you know, and you never know what that's going to be.
Yeah.
I think it's about the place, the time, and the individuals involved.
Right. And for me, there was a whole bunch of emotional stuff behind it that I won't go into whole details, but it was very cathartic for me. I was my dealing with loss as well as with something new. So. Right.
No, I do. I think that's fair in that case. Now,
I was actually going to challenge back of, I think there might be another way to interpret the results from the tests.
Okay.
So you know how the question was, they gave you 7 answers and you had an extreme on either end and then you had neutral in the center. So it was split in thirds. So if you look at the results on the tests, if you split them into thirds, are you on the higher end or the lower end of each one of those thirds? Because that will specify your actual interest in that realm. So for example, you're probably, if you're leaning towards Dom, you're probably going to, on all the different categories, be on the higher end in that top third for Dom categories. But if you're scoring lower in that section, it means you're probably not strong in it. And likewise, in the middle section, you probably have an interest of some sort because you didn't answer yes or no to the extreme. But are you leaning towards the upper end or the lower end? And so if you look at your own results on there, like for me, most of my top ones are 80% or above. But I don't have a whole lot underneath that until you get to the very middle. And then there's a gap as you get to the very end, which is zeros.
Right.
Yeah.
I didn't know if that changed anybody else's results.
I'm looking at yours, Tony. I'm looking at the drastic sort of jump because you go from 71% to 58%.
Yeah.
Well, there's already a big jump between 80 and 71.
Right.
Although, but
if you look at what my items are, but
80 then goes up by 7, goes up by 8.
Yeah, like your bottom third, Tony, are below one third, like less than 33%.
Yeah.
So
on those items,
yeah,
it tends to be like my last 5 items are boy girl. Because even though I identify as boy, that's more age related, and that's not a thing for me.
Right.
Daddy, mommy, that's not going for daddy in the gay sense. That's going for daddy, mommy in the age sense. So again, that's way at the bottom for me. Brat tamer. I have so many brats in my life, but I can't say that I'm a tamer.
Okay, so I will say this, Tony. I am surprised as to how low brat is.
Oh, I had a boy at one point who would now be qualified as a brat.
Well, I only say that because you're your energy is very fun. And I think of a brat as a fun person who is kind of impish, that like, that kind of wants to get away with things, but also wants to be held accountable. I guess that's my interpretation of it. So that's why I was like, wow, that's kind of a surprise that it's as low, that it's in the bottom third, where it's at. And it's not to say that you aren't. But then again, that's my outside observation. Like, I'm not around you constantly or seeing your day-to-day life or any of that kind of stuff. So
I'm not as much of a brat as I'm an enabler. So bratty is more I'm projecting what my desires are. Mm-hmm. Whereas if somebody comes to me and says, hey, I want to do this, I may giggle with glee and let them do it, knowing that it may not go well for them. That's the brat energy there.
That's the voyeur in you.
Yep.
Ye old 99%.
Yeah, I hadn't thought of it in those thirds, like you said. So I do find that interesting.
I mean, just kind of think about how you position in those each one of those segments as to if you're on the upper end of that third or if you're on the lower end, because mm-hmm. that'll probably tell you where you are. Like a lot of the upper end of my middles, for example, are switch related. So like I have been a switch in the past. I'm not as much one now, but I do have the capability. I can do it. It's just not usually my focus.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So it's a meh, but I can do it.
My upper third is relatively the same between in the 5 years between doing this. Because the only thing that has dropped out of that upper third is switch. And what? No. Switch actually came up from the third, and then Primal Prey mm-hmm. dropped down.
Right.
And so did Brad.
It's the same number of them. My brat did drop down. So what did that get replaced with?
Warrior. Oh,
vanilla.
Yeah, vanilla creeped up.
Yeah.
And I'm going to admit, I have no idea how it says 47% vanilla for me.
You're just neutral on it?
I guess it's the lower end of my myth.
Well, I mean, I guess that is another thing. Like, how do you interpret the results? Like, what exactly does that mean to you on a personal right. level? They say that vanilla people enjoy regular standard sex and relationship models. Nothing wrong with that as long as you're having fun. Right. So I think they're basically saying, like, there's nothing out of the ordinary or uncommon, I guess, or, you know, non-normal about that particular aspect. So if that's the case, one could interpret it as like in a same gender relationship. If you wanted to ascribe a binary, you would say that one's the dom, one's the sub, one's a top, one's a bottom, one gives, one receives. Like, so I think is like quote unquote normalcy. That's what that could possibly represent. And if that's how you think, like if you continue to ascribe the models that have been put out there to date, that would make sense. As to what they mean with that.
And lower third. That raises an interesting question, though.
Mm-hmm.
So in the scenario of like dom sub, again, in the gay community, we tend to a lot of times think of one-on-one, but are you thinking one to many? Because one dom could have multiple subs.
Yeah.
So would that change your answers if you were not the only sub?
Huh.
Or did you even consider it?
I don't think I considered it, because I remember seeing questions regarding like multiple partners and polyamory and those kind of things. So I kind of knew that that was another facet of the question, but I don't think I don't think it would have changed my answers in a way. I don't think it would have, but I it's hard to say. I've seen a lot of friends and whatnot that have, you know, their polycules slash, you know, dom, sir, you know, relationships, their kink relationships, like spreading all over the place. And it's rather interesting. There are some that I think are genuine, and there are some that I worry are just collectors.
Mm.
And that's the part that maybe if I were thinking about this again, I would put into consideration. Yeah, because I'm not a fan of collectors. I've never been a fan of collectors. I think that is, you are losing why you're doing what you're doing.
Right.
You're losing the importance of what is going on, and it feels more, you're looking for some kind of status, which I hate to say it doesn't exist. And that's where, like, I don't want that. I would rather you, if this is going to be a genuine thing and you're actually interested in engaging someone and teaching them or guiding them in a way, you would know your limits personally and be able to focus on those people individually and completely. Whereas I feel like someone that has like 10 or so subs, like, how would you do it?
But by contrast, you change that to, instead of being dom sub, it becomes handler and puppy. Mm. And one handler have multiple puppies. Would that change that relationship? I think a lot of it is how you, when you go into the question, what you feel you are, may right. change how you view it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, one of the things, like, I was looking at their info, like their definitions, kind of how they were grouping things. And one of the things they say about dominant is some are dominant only in the bedroom. Others are dominant throughout their daily life as well. Unlike the top roles, being dominant is more about who decides what happens than about the contents of what happens. So to them, they're using it as like a power dynamic as opposed right. to like, because they explain like when they say unlike top roles, and then they say like giving pain, bondage, or degradation. But that's interesting because there's no such thing as like top and bottom in like the results. Like they don't use those labels. And I was like, huh. So to your point, Tony, when you're asking about like, you know, pup and handler, I feel like the way they describe dominant, I think they would consider that a handler because it's a person who decides what happens.
Right.
So in that case, there's a presumption on my part. I feel like the handler is the person who's deciding what's happening for the pup. That's
in a ways. Yeah.
Yeah.
I would almost say that it's giving that flexibility of, like I mentioned before, like a dom doesn't necessarily have to be an actual top. They could be a bottom. And so they're basically saying, look, the dom is making the decisions. How that happens and what has been decided for or agreed upon, they're the ones that have control of the situation versus somebody who doesn't. And at least in the case of like thinking this along the gay lines, because we're gay, is it doesn't have to be a specific position. While some of the other things, it is about position and role in the scene. Well, the dom sub position doesn't really have a position specifically, just who has the control. That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
Hope that made sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, someone in the live chat stated Payson. Hey, Payson. I do know the occasional submissive handler. He laughs, but like, yeah, I think that's often, there is a case for that. There are people that are, you know, can be a submissive handler. I can see that. I can totally see that being a thing. Not necessarily like do whatever you want kind of thing, but just a like more of a that someone like the pup is active or the pet is actively like asking him, and the submissive handler is like yes or no or maybe or whatever. I can see that being sort of a way. Interesting.
And I mentioned it only because like the questions of earlier I mentioned the struggle with doing daddy. Like to me, daddy is one of those roles where if you're in the gay sense a daddy, you probably have multiple people you are daddy of.
Right.
And I could see doing that role, but for the purpose of the test, I couldn't see putting daddy.
Right. Same. Yeah. Same.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
I'm a little somewhat surprised-ish by my results. A little bit. Especially the change. I don't remember when I first took the test, or which is where the first results came from.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it was earlier on in my kink journey, I want to say. But seeing what I have now, like the top one being voyeur,
Well, your percentage stayed the same.
Yeah.
It just rose to the top of the list. And your 100% before is now second.
Yeah.
And then your second is now third. So that kind of, those two things shifted down. And that kind of, I think, created the differences. Because otherwise, some of your stuff is pretty similar in percentage. Like, it's not that far off.
Right.
So you're just as committed now to being a voyeur as you were then.
9 times out of 10, Damon will be a voyeur.
I feel from my results, looking at the difference, is I think I've become more focused on what I like or what I'm interested in.
Right.
Because I have a bit more stuff towards the top, but I have so many things in the lower third. I had a lot more in the middle than I did before. So it feels like, okay, these things I'm much more about. Yeah, this is not something I'm interested in. I have really more focused on the stuff that's at top. I still don't know how my rope bunniness dropped by 4 points. Because I'm still 100% on that.
I think things shifted so because of just like
followed by Tony, come walked up to me with a rope in hand before he could smile and tilt his head for consent. I'd be just shaking my head up and down really, really quickly.
So you'd be enthusiastic submissive, okay? Well, what I was going to say, Jeff, I just noticed about yours is. Your top 10 are all above 50%, and then suddenly everything else is under 40%. Like, there's a huge gap between your 10th and 11th categories. Like, the most severe distance between two, I think, out of all of us.
Going from 59% at Brat down to 37% for Age Player.
Right, it's a 22% difference. And I think it's the most severe out of all of us. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just pointing it out. Well, no. Tony has a 23% difference between Switch and Exhibitionist. But that's pretty like telling.
Yeah.
You know,
again, I think it's because I've become more informed and I've watched more stuff on porn. I've become more focused on what turns me on.
Right.
Fair.
Which makes sense. Fair. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's sort of what we were talking about earlier. More informed, you kind of know, like, you might know more about what you're into and what you're not into. So, like, say, like, some of the questions were, like, talking about, for me, like, I don't think I would ever, although it's higher than I thought it would be, I don't think I would ever consider myself going into a slave portion of this. I don't feel that way personally. But, that maybe, I'm a little surprised at where it is on the test, but it is in my lower third. So it kind of makes sense to me why it's there. I've become a lot more knowledgeable about the things that I enjoy and the roles I want to play in certain scenarios. Mm-hmm. And that's just come from experience, education, and trust. Yeah.
And experience is a lot of it. I mean, if you don't have knowledge and experience in a category, you're probably not going to be able to answer authentically as to how you feel on it. You'll have ideas, but you won't necessarily know, oh yeah, that is my thing.
Right. And exposure. I think that was one of the words we said earlier. I think that's another one too.
There's a lot on this test.
Tony is mean. And you just sent the link to another one and I'm already taking it.
Well, I was just going to say, so this is one version. There's another one out there called the kink test. So at Tony's suggestion, I think we'll reconvene in the future and we'll have a similar discussion about how that one comes out. I'll be curious to see what we think of as the differences between the two.
I haven't touched it in years, so I'm not sure what they've updated since then. But at one point, it was very much like checking out a John Waters film and having to go look up all of the terms.
Wow.
Well, and it does say it's 65 questions. So I don't know if I want to say that's more in-depth, because the BDSM one I want to say is 1, 2. So it's like grouped 7 at a time, and I want to say there's probably 6 or 7 screens.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think you notice quite as many, like how many questions you're answering. So they might be relatively similar, but yeah.
That would be suggestion for next time.
Yeah, I think that's...
Yeah.
I think it's a good suggestion. Anything else before we wrap up?
I think I will say, take this test, and if you have questions or are interested, please reach out, seek education. Don't go running to like your next, you know, the first person you find on your search for like Rope Bunny and go run off to find them and such, but just well informed as well armed. And there are just know to kind of that there are people out there that do use this kink community in the negative way, and just to be wary. And if you have those red flags, if you feel those red flags, trust them completely, because this is a different situation and there is the potential of being hurt in more ways than one. So,
right.
Yeah. So if you're a newbie to this, absolutely. Like, think about it, but ask questions and get some information. I would say, you know, Tony here, maybe me in a ways, could really be great to answer questions or give guidance or get you to someone that might know a bit more about it than you would.
Agreed.
There's always more to know.
Wise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For sure.
And I would also say for anything that if people are taking this and they find something that is a complete turnoff, acknowledge it, recognize it. But you may also want to figure out why because that could be a sign of other issues, like something else that might cause an issue during a scene, for example.
Mm-hmm. Very fair. Jeff?
Oh,
stop sorry, taking the test.
Squirrel.
Jingle the keys, jingle the keys.
Kink.
In any case, sadly, that's the end of the show. Sorry. I'm going to get to this test. So go to comesoutloud.com if you want to leave a comment on the blog. Shoot us an email at comesoutloud@gmail.com. Leave us a voicemail at 361-COL-TALK. That's 361-265-8255. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube at comesoutloud in the appropriate place in the URL. I'm now scheduling the streams. As soon as I have art and stuff to put in the thing so that I can post the scheduled stream. So you can find out when we're planning on recording that by going there or going to your Google Calendar at bit.ly/calendar-col. You can also join our Drawn for Us chat at bit.ly/telegram-col. You can also get various accoutrements at our Zazzle store at zazzle.com/cubsoutloud, where we got more work from Smashy. We got our hugging specialist, our belly rubbing specialist, our kissing specialist. Shirts available, as well as ones we teased in a previous episode because it tickled Gary when I said whatever the Cubs are saying these days. Well, you can get your very own. It doesn't have to be Cubs. It could be Bears, Boys, B-O-I-S or B-Y, Daddies, Queens, whatever. You'll see. There's a lot of them. Took me a long time to get them posted because way things were working. I had to do it one way for dark shirts, one way for light shirts. You'll see. But it's all available over at saddle.com/cubsoutloud. You can find more of Smashy's work at tpublic at tpublic.com/users/smashy. Please support him. We appreciate him so very much. You also can become a patron at patreon.com/cubsoutloud or send us a donation at paypal.me/cubsoutloud. You can find us on the various podcasting platforms. Please rate or review us there. The more thumbs up everybody we get, the more people will find us in the algorithm. You can find me anywhere on the internet as Box at Box Puppy Box Cub Box Cubby, bigger city, or something or other at and anywhere you can find me on the internet. Damon.
If you wish to get in touch with me, you can find me as TheaterCub79. That's TheaterCub79. Our most related sites are on Facebook. Or you can find me as Pup_Umber on Twitter, or Pup_79 on Blue Sky. Those are not safe for work. For the safe for work stuff, you want to go to DMAGamer79 on TikTok or Twitter. Gary?
If you would like to get in touch with me, you can pretty much find me anywhere online as GearBearer73. Tony, if folks were to get in touch with you, how would they do so?
Easiest is probably Blue Sky these days. Cubs is there, but after hearing this, I probably have to get back into my FetLife account, so I'm also Cubs is there.
And with that,
that's fair.
Say goodnight, everybody.
Goodnight, everybody.
Have a good one, y'all.